Hey everyone, it's Blockchain Bernie here with my latest episode, and this one is a little bit different. It's about the social aspects of Web3. It is not a technical thing. It is about the why. Why do we as humanity pursue Web3, and why is it inevitable? I'll dive into all of the details of the evolution of life in general and the evolution of humans in particular, and how we move forward to strive to be more and more self-controlled and, you know, control our own destiny, why that is all happening. So this episode is all about the why, and if you like content like this, please give me that like button. It really, really helps the YouTube algorithm. And if you haven't done so yet, please also consider subscribing to my channel. And since this is a very, very controversial subject that I'm discussing today, please leave me some comments on what you think about these things. And I know it's controversial. It might even be slightly political in some things, even though I think it shouldn't be political, and I don't mean it in any political way. But hey, let's consider evolution, right? At some point, animals became social. Probably they were social from day one. If we think of microbes in the ocean billions of years back, they were already interacting with each other. And then if we think about social animals, what comes to mind immediately is insects like ants or bees or something. And if you think about that, their destiny is determined. If you are born as a worker bee, you know exactly what to do. And, you know, you do your work and you cannot say just, oh, today, you know, I don't want to be a worker bee. I just want to take a day off and have some fun on the Las Vegas Strip right there. And no, you know, it's kind of programmed in those insects' brains, and communication is very, very rigid, right? So there is a one-way communication from the queen to the workers to all these different roles, and also with those ants, and you know, their determination, their choice to control their own destiny is very, very limited. So now think humans or mammals in general, right? Most of you have cats or dogs or anything, right? All these are social animals also, but you know, their way to control their own destiny is also quite limited, right? So sometimes we see these things in our pets, obviously, and we have a border collie, so they are quite intelligent animals, and they are known to do their own thing at times, right? And we can definitely tell with Schubert, our dog. But if you think of humans, we went through a history also, and in the early years, communication was quite limited. We could all only communicate within our tribes, and that resulted in that tribalism, and you know, if someone from a different tribe intruded into our territory, we saw them as enemies and things like that. So communication was limited, and over time, communication, that was a key to human development, right? Because suddenly, then, you know, at some point, Gutenberg invented the printing press, right? And that enabled a whole bunch of new ways to communicate and to conserve knowledge and to give knowledge to ancestors and all these type of things. And that enabled us to have more control over our own destiny and do what we think is right rather than blindly believing some authorities, right? And as we think of the ants and the bees, they have to blindly believe their authorities, right? Mammals develop and then humans develop, and then they invented the printing press. And about that time with the printing press, you know, the kind of blindly having to follow the rules of some emperor or, you know, head of the tribe or whatever, it slowly, slowly faded because people could have their own knowledge. We could communicate end to end with each other rather than, you know, the before that, communication was so difficult to stay up to date with developments and what are the current threats outside of our tribe and stuff like that. So we had to believe our leaders, right? There was not even a press and nothing. So we had those kings and emperors and, you know, all these that we had to believe and play by their rules. But then, you know, about the same time as the printing press was there, people wanted to become more more self-controlled, right? Self-determined and take control of their own destiny. And that resulted in things like here in the US, the Boston Tea Party, and over in Europe, the French Revolution, and all these type of things that basically resulted in, you know, more democracy, and more democracy also means, you know, less monarchy, obviously. So republics were formed, and we were way more able to control our own destiny and to free ourselves from the tyranny of, you know, emperors. So, and that, you know, accelerated with the advent of the internet. With the advent of the internet, this sort of being self, being your own boss, being the master of your own life, that became so much easier with the internet and especially social media, because people could communicate with each other. They can get information from everywhere. With the internet, you can get in contact with people of your interests anywhere in the world, right? If before the internet, you live in some, you know, small town, XYZ, 30,000 population, it's gonna be tough to find even a handful of people with your interests, right? So, and with the internet, you can do that. So you can get some confirmation from others. Is this the right way we want to do? And we want to move that way. And if some authority tells you, hey, this is the way to go, you can connect with others and you can find out what is the way that you want to go. You can get confirmation that others did the same and it worked for them, right? So you become more and more the master of your own destiny, right? And, you know, if you think about that, if we think about the web applications that we have right now, as much as they have helped us to become more the masters of our destiny, right? So I'm super grateful we have all these web applications that are centralized these days, but they have brought people together, right? The Facebooks, the Twitters of this world, the Googles, and also apps like eBay, Etsy, Shopify, you know, Airbnb, all these type of things, right? They bring people together, and sometimes it's also called the share economy. So people can do business with each other or, you know, interact with each other through these platforms. But the platforms today are all centralized, right? If Airbnb doesn't like you, if eBay doesn't like you, if Facebook doesn't like you, they can cancel you, right? And they 100% create the rules, and everyone has to play by these rules. And it's tough for us to get alternatives because there's the so-called network effects. So when people are on that specific platform, it is tough for them to move somewhere else, right? And that's where Web3 comes into play, because all these web apps that I mentioned, those are all centralized control, right? They're, when I say centralized, you know, some people say, oh, it's not centralized. Facebook has servers all over the world, right? Of course, they are distributed. and decentralized geographically, but the control is centralized. You know, Google as a company, Airbnb as a company has 100% centralized control over all of their servers. And that in that company, the CEO has 100% centralized control over all of that company. So this is all centralized. And if you really think about it, it resembles a little bit the old times when we had kings and queens and emperors and all these type of things. It was a form of authority that we just have to follow, and we have to follow their rules. And with Web3, we have the opportunity to free ourselves even from that. It's just the next step of evolution, and it gives us more power to determine our own destiny. If these platforms are not, do not have centralized control anymore in the future, they can have decentralized control through the blockchain. And there are a lot of challenges, technical challenges, if we can really do that or not. You know, right now, it's like, well, Web3 is something like a thought experiment, but we cannot really do it for some technical reasons. And with my own company, Bitoku, so the link is in the description, bitoku.io, we're a Web3 startup that adds the storage layer to blockchains, to smart contract blockchains. And with that storage layer, finally, we can have decentralized control, not only of code execution, we can do that today already with, you know, platforms like Ethereum, Solana, Avalanche, you name it, all those L1 smart contract platforms. But we don't have a storage layer for them that is also decentralized control. And that's what we're building at Bitoku. I couldn't be more excited to work on that. But today is not the day to dive into the details on how we do that. I have other videos about that. So don't forget to subscribe to the channel to get notified when new content comes out. Today's video is about the why, and why are we doing that? And I think this path that we are on as humanity, it is inevitable. It is completely inevitable that we want to more and more be the masters of our own destiny. And you, if you open your eyes, you see that everywhere. If you read the press, if you read social media, you see it everywhere. People are less and less willing to accept authorities blindly, right? And that's a trend that has been there for ages. And this trend will continue. It is inevitable. And Web3 is the way to finally free ourselves from the Web2 apps that have centralized control and that just dictate the rules, right? And we want to be the ones that set the rules. The users, the owners themselves want to control their own destiny. And that's what Web3 is all about. And I'm super, super excited. And it's a great time to live in to see the next few decades of Web3 development. And I personally feel it's a it's one of the big drivers of innovation in the next few decades. And everyone's talking about AI these days. We're talking about sustainable energy and all these type of things. But, you know, if I think about the next 10, 20 years, I think blockchain technology with Web3 is going to be one of the main drivers of innovation. And it's going to change society. It's going to change humanity in a very, very profound way. That's just my personal opinion. That's why I am working and devoting my time on these things. If you want to learn more about Bitoku, again, link is in the description, bitoku.io. There is a light paper. You can participate. You can get a license to run a validator node in that future Bitoku chain. And yeah, thanks for watching. And I want to know your opinion. What do you think of that, right? Do you think I'm right? Or is this trend reversible? Or are we just going to be a society where we do accept authorities and Do we want to have centralized organizations where we can turn to, right? If something goes wrong, it's always good to have a centralized organization and we can say, hey, you know, this didn't work. Please help me, right? With decentralized organizations, it often does not work. And we have to find ways on how the decentralized application can still help us, right? And build decentralized Web3 apps that actually have these support mechanisms and repair mechanisms that we all love. Thank you guys for watching. This was a very, very important video to me. And I do want to know your opinion. Please leave me comments. I want to know what you think about this very, very important subject. Thanks for watching and catch you guys later.